acting on the side, got Gordy his knife, and properly told him how to train with it. And yes, I did check to confirm, if you do not have survival, and you do not do that, he loses fingers. Oh god, he loses fingers. Before we leave, there's a little weird icon that says Grieving Mother over here. The woman looks briefly through you as if she doesn't know you're there. Middle-aged peasant woman is dressed in a brown leather cloth draped down to her knees. Her hands are working at separating stringy, colorless vegetables in a pile before her, ripping the heads off the long, fibrous stems with a paring knife. She discards the stems one by one, placing the heads of the vegetables into a small cradle-like basket in front of her. She doesn't greet you as you approach. You're not sure she even knows you're there.
Excuse me, ma'am? Ma'am, are you saying potatoes?
The woman doesn't respond. She keeps stripping the heads from the vegetables with a steady rhythm. Maybe death, but there's no indication she heard you. Study the woman? At first glance, she seems nothing more than a middle-aged woman. Unremarkable, maybe less stern than most, who seems so more focused on the weaving in her lap than her surroundings. Yet, you suddenly notice she's not stripping the vegetables before her any longer. She's weaving, and the vegetables' pots are now missing. She's a potato master? She still pays you no mind, her brown locks torn and snagged from lack of washing, like many of the townsfolk you've seen. A strange blur to her. The motions of her hands seem to be playing with the threads that lack color, and a shape that lacks interest. It may be that she's half-minded, or death, or something feels wrong. As you watch, her knitting takes on an odd cadence, and you have a terrible suspicion that something lurks beneath what your eyes are showing you. She looks possessed. Brown hair is long, almost impossibly to the length of her hands. As you follow the streams of her locks downwards, the hairs become long and black, splitting off into threads of black and silver and wrapping around her hands. Wait, wrapping? Is she using the hair? She's forming a soul cradle with the threads, braiding a net in front of you, each finger long and sharp like a series of knitting needles, almost hypnotic. Silver and black strands of her hair weave together, with silver predominating as a highlight, black shadowing it. You suddenly are calm. On a plateau, almost at the height of a tower several stories high. The plateau is like a table lying beneath a clear sky, and beneath the plateau, surrounding it in all directions, a forest hazy with mist. Though whether it is actual mist or distance or recollection. Resting in the curve of the natural arc above you is a great copper bell, half again the size of a man, hanging at attention, as if looking down on you and even the unfolding before you. Plateau is soaked in the sun, and the rock beneath you is rough and warm. The sky forms a cradle around you. You feel different. Not disembodied, but you feel your body, your physical contours, have changed along with the surroundings. For a soft series of chimes, like wind chimes. Hey, buddy! Morning! The sound gains color and texture. But the sound is beckoning you gently forth, filling your senses and thoughts. Mist rolling softly into a still chamber and... focus on the chimes? Chime coaxes you deeper into the memory, and you're certain it is a memory, a warm one. Stone of the plateau, and your knees on the warm texture of the ground, silver, white, shimmering like Aedra. The plateau is formed of it, glistening in the sun. You can feel the heat on your skin, wrists, and your hands, and your hands are in motion. Weaving, not thread, but gathering, tenderly moving along the first movements of Barris' wheel. Your hands are wet, your hands are upon the flesh. Newborn child, and you can feel the crowning of a tiny head turning into your grip, its head slick, wet. The hands you are wearing and inhabiting have done this many times, and they are practiced and confident. You can feel distant pains in your own head as the head emerges, a stream of fluid from the wound helping the newborn slid forth, and a woman's labored breathing crying out, "Oh, we're having a baby!" Yeah, that's about as far it's going right now, actually. Focus on the child. Breathe! As your hands move, you hear the sound of chimes, clear cutting through the haze of memory. You do not see where they are coming from, but they are close, and they are meant as comfort, or that you are certain. Draw the child forth. Cooks by your hands, every movement causing the chimes to sound again. Most eagerly, the child comes forth, and as it does, your hands are in motion, weaving, moving along the length of a soft, wet rope. No, an umbilical cord from the legs of the naked woman before you. Oh, we're not having the baby. We're helping the baby. We're a wet nurse. Got it. You're holding a small child, still wet, from the wound before you. The child cries out, its cry full of life, full of soul, the ringing of chimes echoing in its thoughts, filling it with its welcome. The soul's blurred at the edges, as if you were viewing a soul from within a soul. But it is there, alive. The woman before you is weeping, and at first, her cry, her hand... Wait, is she a cipher? Because we haven't really come across that as a companion, right? Her hands reach out, surrender the child. You surrender the child to her, something you've done many times before. Your hands move, the chimes echo the movement, and you realize the chimes are hanging from cords on your wrists. Where once they echoed in the memory, they're now echoing the child's mind as well. Chimes are intended to welcome the child to be its first gentle greeting to the world. Soothing sound guided by the tender motions of your wrists. We're helping to weave its thoughts, its perceptions, and the experience. The experience. The woman laughs with a ragged joy, laughing from a parched throat. Her emotions seem soothed. Physical demands of labor have left her exhausted. The child's here, the child's safe. All atop the plateau is peaceful, calm, distant, flattening out as memory persists. Pull back. With effort, the scene bleeds of color, and your mind becomes your own again. There's no pole, no anchor, yet the sound of the chimes remains. Existent in the memory, they sound here as well. They're hanging from woven braids on the wrist of the woman before you. Even as your head is spinning from the touch of her mind, the sound of the chimes on her wrist is sharp and clear, as if coaxing you back to the real world. The woman still sits before you, but she's nothing like you what her saw. She's wearing black, shredded garments that drape over her like her form like streamers. Her hair streaks of black and run through with silver. Her age is almost impossible to tell. She simply feels old. I know that feeling. Like a crumbled watchtower. As she lifts her head to face you, you see that her hair is draped across the front of her face like a veil. What you first saw of her as a mental glamour of some sort, unconscious. You realize what you see is not what the world sees, and you are perhaps the first one to see her true self. Still, you don't sense a threat in the realization. If anything, you feel a sense of relief from the figure. You can hear her thoughts, and she is glad to at last be seen. What did you do to me?
I am seen, but the eyes of others do not remember. You were the first to see me as I am, the call stripped aside.
Sorry, are you cursed? There is a light touch on your mind, a caress, and her left hand mirrors the motion of the touch, reaching up to the air between you. You hear the chime on her wrist sound softly, her hand moves as if pantomiming, resting on your cheek at a distance. She speaks softly and slowly.
Your memories. A cadence of wheels on a caravan track. Fever. Questions by running water. Violence in a night's campfire. Arrows in the dark. And fleeing, falling rock and cracking stone, and a storm. The storm.
Totally a cipher, right? Unless she's another watcher, in which case. She swallows, and the chime sounds as her hand shakes. She stops, her hand frozen in the air.
The storm that brushed you, did its screaming wake you from your mind's cradle? Your memory of it is painful. Its cry is difficult to ignore. It's like a child. Many children crying out.
I might have encountered a biwak. Her hand withdraws shyly, the chime sounding softly once again. The woman stands uncertainly as if she had been sitting for some time, or is too weak to bear her own weight. Notice her cheekbones are tight, her face gaunt. Yet while her stance is weak, she seems determined to stand before you.
You are able to see me.
It's almost a question. Suddenly realize she doesn't know what you saw when you looked at her, the image on the plateau. If the image was so clear, so sharp, you're surprised she didn't feel you there.
To see me is a rare gift. A watcher's gift.
Okay, so she's... Cypher? I thought the Cyphers were really going to be good at, like, being detectives, but if they're just great at just mimicking their surroundings and then just being a spy, damn. I've never been able to do that with a living person except with you.
So many questions, thoughts whirling like storm winds. That storm still roars through you, deep beneath your thoughts, yet muted and secret, like an underground river. I cannot tell if it is carving new channels or eroding what keeps your true strength buried.
Is her name just going to be Grieving Mother?
The fact that you could hear it at all, survive it, is something few have ever done. Your power will grow stronger with each soul you touch, as it allowed you to reach out to mine.
There is a silence, and though it seems to last for but a heartbeat, your thoughts, it stretches out between the two of you like a pole between your minds. Think, your breath, you realize she wants to ask you a question. You can't form the words, if assembling them is painful, simply not enough pieces. Do you wish to travel with me? You feel a wave of fear gusted with the strength of relief, although oddly her expression does not change. Then fear dissipates and you feel strength and certainty as if the plateau from her memory lies beneath you and calm sky looks down upon you. Yes? Durant's for right now.
You walk your path, I'll walk mine.
He seems pissed. Okay, what are you? She jingles. That's a weird thought. She jingles, chat. Aggressive. Cypher. She's a cypher. Okay. Shocks enemies' visual receptors, dazing and blinding them as well as blinding nearby targets. Target becomes the object of a concussive blast of psychic energy, suffering raw damage from the trauma. Characters in a conical area behind the target, failing a fortitude check, are knocked prone from the blast. Good right there. Imparts a bedeviling secret to an enemy that causes its allegiance to bend, charming them for the duration. Ooh. Is she melee? Kinda, I think. Maybe? Light armor, right? Co-ops the target's essence, generating a slashing blade of force that attacks them before leaping up to 5 additional targets. Fades the minds of the targets in the area effect, causing them to believe they're surrounded by phantom photos, hitting them flanked for the duration. That's real good. Causes the target to relive the psychic trauma of an injury moments after receiving it, experiencing the damage all over again. Violates an enemy's memories. Bring vivid recollections of past failures to the surface, leaving them hobbled and weakened. Of course, the target's psychic defense is leaving them dominated by the cipher for the duration. Of course, the enemy's soul to leak energy, adding the air around them and burning them over time. I was unaware that your soul could be leaky. Provides an ally with a mental block of hit on his or her pain, granting a bonus to their damage reduction. Produces a psychic howl in the target area, stunning the target as well as dealing raw damage. Okay. Gonna be good or bad?
All right then.
Can I talk to her? Are we actually going to?
Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
I do have questions. Let your mind speak for you. I shall listen past the words. You addressed me as a watcher when we met. Do you know what a watcher is? A slow chill, and for a moment it seems as if she's going to fade from your vision, as if she can't bear to be seen.
The title came unbidden. I do not know why I spoke of it. Yet It seemed the right mantle, a familiar one.
She seems awfully shady. Yet I do not know from where it came. If I have given offense... If I've given offense, forgive me. Forgive me. You could know more than I. Oddly enough, it feels as if she's not speaking to you. It feels like she's speaking to an audience. The air takes on a curious edge, a chill, which persists for a short moment, then fades into a dull fear. Have you encountered us before? I do not know. It's an odd feeling. I do not know where it stems from. The word that arose when you saw me. This said watchers see much that others do not, and I have been hidden from the eyes of others for time. So about the hidden thing, is this a cipher thing or is this a curse thing? How is it no one sees you?
Their eyes see me, but Their minds will not remember past the call.
What's the call? A call?
My face is like the call of a newborn, hiding the face beneath. And for my body, I am able to wrap myself as a mother cradling her child. I am here, as you see me. But to them, their eyes see only the cloak that I wear. A peasant mother, dirty, shabby, not worth knowing.
And you do this because...
As a watcher, you see more than others. To the eyes of most, I am as unseen as the spirits you share memories with.
How are you able to affect minds? I divert the flow of their senses down a different path, to a place easily forgotten. Not unwelcome when one does not desire the presence of others. The surface of their mind registers a figure, but the memory slips away. To see a woman, there is no desire for conversation, no desire for any questions. And I have none to ask. Okay. Why, though? I was able to enter your dream.
I do not know. What do you speak of? If you were in my thoughts, I could not feel your presence, nor do I know what you saw there.
As she speaks, you suddenly feel an odd sensation in your mind, with the blood of a hunt welling up in you. You suddenly realize that whether she permits it or not, you could enter her dream and observe it without her ever knowing. There is something about her mind like a weapons rack, where you could reach in and draw forth a blade if you wished and keep it as your own. Suddenly, you find yourself back in her, your present thoughts. Though you were away for but a moment, she seems unaware of your diversion of thought. It may be one of your gifts, an ability to walk in memories as easily as someone walks upon the ground. That's a little intrusive, right, Chad? Like, just... I feel like if she wants to talk to us, you know, she could talk to us. But I don't want to, like, go digging in somebody's memories without consent. Would you like to hear what I saw? A mixture of curiosity and fear wells up between you. She raises her left hand, the chiming at her wrist quelling the rise within her. Frightened, but curiosity anchors her.
And what did you see in my memories? I would hear you speak of them.
Does she not know her own memories? Has she been stripped of her past? And only knows of her abilities and that's it? It was you helping give birth to a child. There is silence, and as your breath falls still, you hear the faint cry of a child in the distance. Newborn child, almost exactly like what you heard in the dream. That's creepy. As you listen, the grieving mother raises both her hands as if weaving, her wrists chiming as she does so. The semblance of a gentle turning she provided while the newborn was crowding. To your surprise, you recognize the motions and the words from the memory, and as they are new to you now. She weaves her hands through the air in front of her. Child's cries grow still. The sound of the chimes weaves almost hypnotically into your thoughts. Your eyes seem sharp and clear, and you feel as if you are towering over your surroundings, as if kneeling atop a great pillar. He did in the memory. To your surprise, the grieving mother falls, as if her strings were cut, her knees crack hard against the ground. Her hands never cease moving in the air, her chimes echoing her movements. In a ragged voice, you hear her speak. The voice is that of a much older woman than the one before you, harsh, almost desperate.
Tell me what you saw. Show me what you saw. Where were you?
Her eyes, now terribly sharp and real, are filmed with white, silver white like Adrian. Dude, I don't know where we were. Oh no. Mountain ledge, I think it was high up. No, I think a huge forest stretching up beneath a rock, great rock. I'm gonna go with snow. She leans back as if looking back at the sky, but her eyes are closed. The film building on them. The slow intake of breath, you feel time become quiet around you. I do not feel the memory. I do not know if it is mine. But thank you for trying. Her hair falls across her features like a veil, and she nods. Not with her chin, but a push in her mind. So about that birth memory? Huge forest?
The stone of the plateau. Its color.
There we go.
Tell me its color.
It was silver Aedra. It was surface warmed by the sun. As you watch, her hands rise before her. She claps them, then cups them, as if feeling them for the first time. And as she stares down in the cradle of her hands, the chimes sound once, twice, and as they swing with the movement.
And what did these hands hold?
They held the mother while she gave birth? She leans back as if looking back at the sky, but her eyes are closed. Oh. Hang on. Alright, so that's number two. Number two. Number one. Oh, okay, hang on. Number two. Number two. Number three. There we go. There's a sudden intake of breath and then a release. Her eyes blurs close, forming into slits. But in the brief glimpse you have of her changing expression, rippling pain in her features seems to have... She swallows once, twice, and then you feel her once again in your thoughts, the rasping husk of her voice swallowed and drained from within her.
It was the birthing bell you saw. Has it been so long? Have I forgotten so much?
There is surprise, followed by a rising horror swirling beneath the words. Okay. What happened to you, girl? Words comes a river of impulses, thoughts as if loosed from a breaking dam. As her mind wraps the impulses into words, you realize it is her muscles and her hardened thoughts relaxing and breathing again. Such an intensity, you almost want to step back from the flow, but you find the wave of impulses cause questions to float to the surface. Among them is a name. Watcher. What is a birthing bell?
It is a plateau formed of the spirit stone Audra. At its top is set a great bell, cradled in the reaching arm of the plateau. It stirs in the wind, and it sounds for leagues when struck by kith hands. In distant times, the great bell served as a Glanfothan watchtower, perhaps. Why they abandoned it, I do not know. Other men came in time, settlers, and claimed the tower as their own. I, in turn, claimed it from them. The pillar became a cradle where I could draw new souls into the world.
In your memory, were you helping a woman give birth?
Yes. Yet, I believe you only saw a small part of the birthing ritual. It is not all in a moment, nor in a day. It is a journey of many years between the child, the mother, and I.
Huh? Wait a minute. How long does birthing last in this world? Because that, no. There was much I could do to aid the mother. Some thought the physical comforts of rituals to steady their thoughts. An angel for the bell. Others would seek advice, words of counsel for the days ahead. Able to provide droughts, tinctures, and a reading of the child's spirit. Strengthen the mother. Can you tell me about the birthing ritual?
The ritual was one of many steps. It took many tens of years to carve them, but always the child's thoughts were there to guide me. From the moment it began to awaken, to the three seasons within the mother, to the birthing day, and the years to follow, The child's thoughts. That is where it began.
She didn't... Hypothetically, grieving mother here, who still has not given name, she didn't birth Eothis, did she?
The expectant mother. I could often sense her thoughts, and those of her child, before she could. I would soothe her, free her from the panic of questions. I would sound the memory of the birthing bell atop the plateau in her mind, letting the memory of the vibrations fill my thoughts and hers. Often, the child's soul could hear it too, so the sound of the bell echoed in the mother's thoughts.
I'll be honest, this is very confusing. You sense the mother's thoughts. Sharing memories and thoughts can bond lives together, and hardships involve the sharing of what is. The bell itself provided shelter for such thoughts, opportunities, crevice, hollows in the rock where one could find shelter, clefts where you could feel the Adra all around. As she speaks, you feel your legs bend, crossed in the warmth of walls around you, blankets woven thick beneath you. Such shared images can bond souls even tighter and allow them to draw strength from each other. You mentioned the ritual last years? What happened after the birth? Actually, what would happen before the birth? Once the pain is channeled away, the mother and child breathe again. Then the birthing bells on my wrists and allow the mother to hear the child's thoughts, the ringing echoing in each other's thoughts. The bells open the way between them, let her feelings pass into the newborn, let her feel the child in return. Feelings meet, that is when I weave another memory and leave it tied in their minds. Did the bells play an important role? Yes, and for years after. If it's said to the child after delivery, a reminder of the memory the mother and the child shared. You feel an odd sensation of warmth, and you can feel a smile being shared, then it flickers and it's gone. As the bells coax the child forth, so they accompany the child onwards, fastened about the wrists, care for him, mind and body. There is no magic in it except the magic of practicality. If a child sought to leave their cradles or escape their cribs, the mother can know through the warning of the chimes alone. At times the bond was strong, so would I. The sensation of a smile comes again, slower, more knowing between you. Not watch, children. Much trouble may be, and from tiny hands. Terrible twos, actually, and god awful threes, and why are there fours? And it just kind of goes up from there, actually. Chimes are kept until the child needs them no longer, but I no longer can hear them sounding in my mind. I know the spirit has changed, and the bonds we shared are long gone, shedding my last many years, or but a few, but it is necessary. Wait, you watched over these children for years after they were born. Children are fragile things. Ties of blood and mind may not be enough. We watched, and even then the body may fail the mind. But if watched, even the most sickly child may cling to life and determined enough. That'd be me. That would be me. And many of their souls were tied to me. If a child's spirit failed, sound the chimes in their mind and grant them strength, even from afar. Always, sir, but it gave hope. It sounds like you've seen tragedy? Enough to never wish it to feel again. In the times before the bell, children who died cast upon the waters of the lake beyond the bell, sometimes while alive, if their past and futures were dead. It was a different time. Children were treated carelessly. Those times are past. Wait, I'm sorry. Timmy, what do you want to be? I want to be an actor. Nope, throw him off the cliff. Becky, what do you want to be? I want to be a politician. That's pretty good. Okay, we got a keeper. Okay, Bobby, what do you want to be? I want to be a clown. Honey, this is a hard line. Do we throw him or do we keep him? Because he might have some enjoyment down the road, but, you know, he's a clown. Okay, she's saying we're keeping him. She's saying we're keeping him. Okay, Bobby, come on over. Terrible. Just absolutely terrible. How old is this woman? So... You know, it's really weird. That gave me no explanation what she does. Like, I got nothing here, chat.
That's fragrant.
Like, I absolutely have nothing here on who the grieving mother is, why is she so hung up on birthing bells. All very confusing. Hey. Oh, crap.
Down in my private quarters, that goes for you and Heron's bootlickers.
Oh.
Greetings.
Oh, sorry, wrong voice. A sturdy, broad-shouldered man wipes his hands on his slacks. He reeks of the same foul compound wafting from the vats, and his arms are stained with dye. Looking to purchase some leather.